All right. Welcome, everyone, to the Change Starts Here podcast. I'm your host, Dustin Odham, and today's guest is someone I've had the privilege of knowing for over 20 years, someone that personally has made a huge impact on my life and development and trajectory in life, and someone I can't thank enough for that impact. But the reason we're bringing on J.W. Marshall today is not about our story. It's really about his experience as a thought leader in the education technology space. He's someone who spent just about every year of his 17 years in the education technology space, as well as being a host of a really awesome podcast on EdTech. He just has a lot of opinions, a lot of insight to bring us. And this is a topic we haven't really touched on the podcast. So I'm very, very excited to have J.W. Marshall. So with that, J.W., thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, Dustin. I am so excited to be on the show. I'm a huge fan. If I name drop some of your past guests and what I've learned from them, I apologize in advance, but I'm like Buddy the Elf today. I'm very excited to be on the show, and hopefully your listeners take away some good content today.
That's awesome, man. So let's start out. Who are you and what do you love about what you do?
Perfect. I love this question so much. I actually use it on my show as well. So congratulations. I am a husband, a father, a son, a brother, a Christian, and a helper of people. I think that's, kind of one of the things that's always been a thread in my life, even since I was young. Why do I love what I do? I love helping other people. I love helping them think in new ways through the podcast. I love helping them gain confidence in themselves, if that's working with educators or working with students. And ultimately, I love helping people reach their potential. And I think EdTech is a great vehicle to help educators reach their potential, to help students reach their potential. My mother was a teacher for 40 years, and so education has always been a passion of mine. And if I can help inspire the uninspired, and I can help people realize their potential, gain confidence, then that brings me joy. That fulfills my purpose.
Can you give us, I had the privilege of knowing you in college, knowing how multifaceted you are as a person, but also how talented you are. And so I think the opportunities to go whatever direction, from music, which some people may not know about you, or all the way to marketing at any company that you wanted to work for. How did you decide to land in the ed tech space?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, my mother was a teacher for 40 years, so I helped her growing up, write papers. I always liked school a lot. To reference one of your past episodes with Michael Horn, I feel like I was gaming the system a little bit, did well in school, but later in life realized there was so much more I could have done just being passionate about learning instead of just trying to get the A or get on to the next thing and kind of that gaming. But for me, I was a business major, as you know, at SMU here in Dallas, and was very involved as a student in student leadership and residence life, and almost went into higher ed right out of school. A lot of people might not know this. And my mother gave me the advice. She said, "You got this business degree. Why don't you go work in the real world for a year? And if you don't love it, go into teaching, go into, administration, go into education." And I really got lucky. I looked for companies that I could put my business skills to use, but are helping impact education, and landed with an amazing company called Study Island, which many of your listeners have probably heard of or used over the last 15 years. It was one of the first online learning programs that really caught on nationwide just over 3 to 5 years. And so I was one of 10 people working there. And 6 years later, I think we had 350 employees, and we acquired other ed tech companies and really kind of paved the way for a lot of online learning. And then after that, to kind of get into my story a little bit, I had a lot of people calling me, reaching out to me on LinkedIn, and saying, "How did you do what you did? And we got this startup and we want to do it too, just like you guys." And so that really kind of was the springboard to my career in consulting with EdTech companies and working with EdTech companies. And I've really been blessed in that that was an amazing, passionate company that helped educators, that helped students. And I've gotten to kind of handpick, just working with those companies with great products, with great people, with great mission, and hearts for serving, and not just making a lot of money or growing a company and selling it, that type of thing, which is kind of the other side of ed tech, right? It is a lot of times a for-profit world, but that does spark innovation. And so there's kind of two sides to the coin, but that's a long answer into kind of how I got into what I was doing. And so many of the companies I've worked with, the people are so passionate, and that the work they do gets to not just impact one classroom or one school or one district, but it gets to impact thousands, hundreds of thousands, even millions of students sometimes. And so it is, it's one step removed. I think at some point later in my career, I want to do some adjunct teaching, maybe a assistant professor or something like that. I have that heart when the time is right. Anyone out there listening has an opportunity for me on the side, let me know. But you know, right now I'm in a great place. I love what I do, and I love getting to help kids. Ultimately, I think there's no greater endeavor than education of our children for our country's sake, for the world's sake. I think everything does start with and end with education. And now it's great recent trends to see pre-K to gray is the new term. Everyone is expected to be a lifelong learner moving forward. It's not just for K through 12. It's not just higher ed, but all of us need to be learning new skills and following our passions so that those opportunities are, we're ready to meet those opportunities as they come throughout our, not just our careers, but throughout our lives.
So two good things. One, I'm going to email this interview to our favorite university president, R. Gerald Turner, down at SMU, to see if I can help with that. But two,
okay,
I've heard a lot of terms, you know, pre-K 12, pre-K through college, pre-K college career ready. You just said pre-K through gray. And I don't think I've heard that a ton of places. Where did you first come across that? And how is that impacting the way ed tech companies are starting to evolve and serve the marketplace?
Yeah, so it's an emerging term over the last couple of years. I think a lot of it has come through the pandemic. As adult learners, it's the fastest growing segment of ed tech right now is adult learners, because there's this new focus on, you see the great resignation right now. People don't want to just have a job. They want to do something that's meaningful and gives them purpose. And now more than ever, you can do that. You can go out and learn new skills online. And whether that's a micro learning course or an online university or everything in between. And even now you're seeing a lot of employers, a lot of companies, especially the Fortune 500s, providing more opportunities for ongoing education, either provided by the company or that they're funding their people to go out there and continue learning, getting better at their skills. It's a fast paced, evolving global economy. And, you know, the jobs that you have today may not be the jobs you have tomorrow. And so I think in the pandemic, it's really shown a light on the need for all of us at every age to continue learning and following our passions. And I think full circle, that gives us even more urgency for K through 12 students, not just to cram them full of facts and figures and get them ready for tests, but to really teach them how to learn and inspire them to want to learn. I think those are the two most important things we can do in pre-K through 12 education is to foster that culture of lifelong learning and passion for learning at every age level. And if we can do that, they're going to be able to, you know, learn for the rest of their lives, which is not just a nice to have anymore. It's really a must have as the world continues to evolve.
Yeah. So from your perspective, focusing on, you know, pre-K 12, what role do you think technology plays in the classroom or in the school building?
Yeah, and I think that's something that we've covered a lot on my Voices of eLearning podcast with a lot of different thought leaders. Really, I think what has happened is we finally, for 20 years, been talking about technology in the classroom and ed tech. And in the last 2 years, it's really set in that it's not, again, a nice to have, or yeah, we have a technology lab, or, you know, we're going towards 1-to-1 in 5 years. It really has become a part of the core instead of a supplement. And that is a really exciting change. I like to say on my show that this is the dawn of the golden age of education, and not just of online learning, but I think the combination of the in-person and the online learning, the technology, is really we're scratching the surface right now, and we're seeing how much more engaging and efficient the learning process can be for students. And really, I think the big hurdle is that a lot of educators were still kind of holding out and a little afraid of technology. Is this coming to take my job? And now that all educators pretty much have been forced by necessity to use technology and leverage it, the vast majority has realized that this is not a replacement for what I do. No computer system or artificial intelligence can inspire a student the way that a real person can. And it's funny, I interviewed Sal Khan for the last episode of my Voices of eLearning season one. And if you go back and play the tape, even Sal Khan says, you know, if you give me a great instructor in person and the best online learning program in the world, I take the in-person instructor every time. It really is no replacement. But that being said, educators using technology have started to realize, oh, wow, this actually can enhance my job and it can enhance the student experience. And I can have meaningful data at my fingertips that's easy to access and easy to act on so that I can spend more time individual instruction, small group instruction, based on what that student needs just in time, right when they need it, versus hours of grading papers, hours of, you know, paperwork and reports and building the strategic plan. And then by the time you implement it, the student's already moved on to the next topic or the next thing. So I think that's the most exciting thing for me, is that educators have sadly had to embrace technology, but I think the silver lining is they've realized that if you use it right, it can be so powerful in enhancing what they do and enhancing the student learning experience. And again, back to my first point, that's what it's all about, giving the students that the tools to be successful and the inspiration and the passion to learn. And I think technology is going to be a part of that from now moving forward.
So, you know, if I'm a district administrator or a principal trying to make decisions about bringing in certain technologies into my district, what are some questions that you think folks should be asking themselves? Or what are some paradigms that they should have as they're trying to choose the right provider for their schools or their district?
That's a great question. And that's actually been a challenge, a growing challenge over the last, I would say, 10 years, is schools are getting more technology, they're getting more devices, but they're not necessarily leveraging them to their fullest. Right. And I think many districts are oversaturated with programs, that there's not enough time in the day to train all the teachers on all the things, because it's a one-off here and a one-off there, and this teacher wanted that, and this school wanted that. And there's a lot of them, honestly, that sit and don't get used. And it's a waste of money. And it's a waste of time if you're going to do kind of a little bit of training and then nobody uses it. So number one, I would recommend doing a real honest audit of all the things you have and who's using what and are things being used. And really, less is more. I think looking for a handful of quality programs and technologies that are really going to support your specific school or district's mission, your, you know, be again, being honest with yourself, where are we at technology wise? And, you know, where are we going, which is probably the most important question. And how can we kind of pare back, kind of prune back, and then really be intentional and strategic with the decisions we make? And then on the other hand, not just doing what everyone else is doing. I know that is a big thing in education. People like to see someone else try it first. But with so many great new technologies emerging, even in the last 2 years, really being open to, new technologies and new platforms that are coming out and gaining momentum very quickly, because you could pick something that was really helpful 5 years ago that is not stayed up with the times and is a little outdated, whereas something within the last year or two, you know, really could be, the future. So it's easier said than done, Dustin. It is, as any administrators listening for sure know, it is, a really challenging situation with so many options, which is a great problem to have, but also which ones do we go with? And then second, I would say really talk to your teachers. I know it sounds simple, but I can't tell you how many times over the years I've worked with companies that the teachers are all bought into something, and for whatever reason, it doesn't get adopted, something else gets adopted, and the teachers don't use it. It's got to be something that the teachers are bought into, and look for partners that are really looking to be your partner, that aren't just a vendor of a software. I would look for partners that aren't charging you by the hour for support. And I would look for vendors that don't have a multi-day training. If it takes multiple days to train you on a platform, it's probably not going to be used because it's not intuitive and easy. It's got to be easy to use. Many programs now don't even really need training. Maybe a 30-minute web recording of the basics, and then teachers should just intuitively be able to log in and use the platform or the software. So if it feels hard in the evaluation process, I would take that as a red flag and kind of run the other direction. You really want those programs that are easy to use and that have teacher support. The other tip I'll give for a lot of districts, what we've seen as far as implementing programs is starting with a limited release, whether that's a few teachers in one school, a few schools in one district, and really pouring into them. And look for those ones where you know that they'll embrace it and they'll be your champions, and have the other schools or the other teachers go, wait a minute, why didn't I get that? Whereas if you roll it out to everyone on day one, a lot of times they're like, oh, this is one more thing being pushed down on me, and I'm not bought in. But if you get them, seeing someone else using it and talking about it, being excited about it, then they're going to want to jump on. It's a little bit of psychology involved there, but that's really worked. And that doesn't have to be multiple years. That could be weeks or months that you kind of roll it out, and you have a little bit of scarcity to create that demand, even within your school or within your district. And once people get to using something that's working, then you're off and running.
That's fascinating. One of the things that you said early in that answer is when you're evaluating programs, there could be technology platforms or programs that you've used to solve certain problems for 5 years, that company may not have been investing to get to the latest, greatest solution. And so they're kind of resting on their laurels, and it may not be moving the needle as well as it could for you. And so to your point, like while it can seem like a crowded market at times, it's something that somewhere in your district or school, you need to be evaluating every year to figure out, is this thing that we're using the latest and greatest and getting us closer to our outcomes, all right?
Yeah. And is it making an impact? That's the number one thing. And so if your test scores have been stagnant, not that that's the only unit of measurement, maybe it is time to change it up. And nowadays, programs should make an impact immediately, within weeks, within months, within 1 year. You should know if it's moving the dial and working. And if it's not, or if it's just a small increment, look for something else, because you hear stories every day. I hear stories every day of technology just changing the game for schools or for districts. And no district should be sitting there with something that's just average. There are really great programs out there. There are really great platforms. And you want to be a part of those success stories. Those should be the norm, not the exception. So if you're not just blown away with the impact, with responsiveness of a company, the partnership model versus the vendor. I think that's becoming more and more important in the pandemic too, is what, not only what does the company provide, but what does the company stand for? And what is the company's mission? Is it, to help every student, increase their reading level? Is it to, bring science into the 21st century, and how do they back that up, with what they, do as a company? I think it couldn't be more important now than ever than just another vendor, just another publisher that, we have this idea to make some content and we hope you like it, good luck. It really is a partnership model now. And, you can't partner with 100 different companies, right? Because even a free trial, a free launch of something isn't free. It takes time. It takes resources. It takes, the opportunity cost of using something else. So really being strategic and not looking just at the dollars, but looking at the impact, and really looking for the wow factor. Companies and products should wow you very early and very often to keep your business. I think schools and districts have never been in a better position of having options and choice. And so if you're not blown away with the products you're using, the companies you're working with, then it's time to really take a hard look at, Are they the best solutions for what you're trying to accomplish as a district or a school?
Yeah. So early in your career, you started at Study Island, which I think was a major breakthrough in innovation and education technology for the education world. What innovations, you can even talk to that, what innovations have you seen in the last 17 years that have caused you to say, man, that's really cool? And what was it about those things that you found so attractive?
Yeah, so I will say at Study Island, and it's finally 15, 17 years catching on everywhere else, the secret sauce was really building content state by state to the standards, not again just for test prep, but because that's what teachers are expected to teach and students are expected to learn. And we were blown away that for years and years, no one else really did that. It was kind of the old school textbook publisher model where the company is the expert and they give you the content and then you have to fit it into your scope and sequence. And it's really, you know, kludgy, and there are a lot of gaps, and teachers end up having to create a lot of their own content. I think the biggest innovation overall is we're getting to that point of content that there's enough out there that teachers don't have to create their own near as much as they used to. So that's really exciting. I think second is there is a lot of really cool artificial intelligence and data, smart data that is out there creating personalized learning paths for students based on their diagnostics and their formative and their summative assessments. So I think that personalization is something we've talked about for 20 years in EdTech, and how great it will be when we finally figure it out. I think a lot of companies are really finally figuring out how to do that, to where the student can be self-guided, self-paced to some degree, but the educator is right there every step of the way, monitoring that progress and really intervening at the perfect moment to see, oh, this student is really starting to struggle here. The AI has tried to help. They need more. And again, uncovering that student, you know, may have some social emotional issues they're going through. I think that's the other thing the pandemic has really brought to light, is the best technology in the world, the best curriculum doesn't do you any good if the students aren't socially emotionally there and not worried about food insecurity, not worried about, you know, their home environment, really, you know, that environment. I think what we're seeing now is educators becoming more the facilitators and the guides of education. Beyond just the provider of content or the lecturer or the kind of old school way that we try to, the paper grader, right, the grade assigner. I think we're really seeing educators step into this new role of curating the right content, curating the right programs, spending the right amount of targeted instructional time individually, small group, and really helping that student be inspired to take ownership of their own learning, because ultimately the teacher can't be there 24/7. And so I think that's probably the most exciting innovation in the last couple of years, that we've seen the integration of technology into the core of the classroom and the student experience, that is just something we've wanted for 20 years in ed tech, and it's finally starting to happen here in the last year or two.
That's awesome. I think, you know, you talked earlier about that term that I'm taking after today is the, you know, pre-K to gray, thinking about folks being lifelong learners. I mean, you and I both talked, I think we were both really successful in college, but yeah, when you introduced me to Michael B. Horn and having a conversation with him about what learning actually looks like, he admitted, and now we have both admitted, that we are more focused on gaming the system than really diving into the love of learning. And obviously we've evolved since then, but like that's kind of my hope and prayer for my kids. How do I get them out of the rat race of just thinking through grades and just have them geek out on learning? You know, Michael B. Horn was one of those like really cool people that you've had on your podcast. And you've had some awesome folks. I'm just curious, are there a couple of pieces of advice or interesting topics you touched on while interviewing folks that really have just stuck with you that you could share with us?
Yeah, there's so many that I don't even know if I can name all of them. But I would say that, oh man, where to start? The other kind of key I think that we're seeing as a reoccurring theme, and I'm actually launching a new podcast just about this topic. Yeah. So I'll continue the Voices of eLearning, and season 2 is ramping up, and we're going to keep asking the question of, you know, how do we continue this momentum that, as we hopefully come out of the pandemic, we don't just go back to the way things were before, because the way things were before in 2019 weren't that great, especially for a lot of student populations, especially for the digital divide and having, you know, a device and a internet connection that was of quality bandwidth, right? And we've made more strides in that direction than ever before in the history of, you know, connectivity. There's still a lot of work to go, but we've really, you know, cut a lot of the red tape and made a lot of things happen. And I hope that continues. But also you hear a lot of thought leaders at the state and the federal level now talking about this importance to accelerate learning, to make up for the learning loss. And so our new show is going to be called Accelerating K-12 Education. And it's really going to talk about how do we build on this foundation of change and how do we really accelerate the rate of student learning? Because that's something that can be accelerated, right? It's not just getting through the content, but getting through it at a faster rate and a more efficient rate. And I think that's my hope, is that this students that have experienced this learning loss will not be the lost generation, but will be the beneficiaries of this change. So that if we can change, you know, the way we do things and improve it and accelerate the rate that these students can learn, they're going to learn more by the end of their student career than they would have if the pandemic wouldn't have happened. But that is a big ask. And so really on the podcast, we talk about let's think big and let's act big. Now is the time. All the ESSER funds and federal funds are coming in. They're not going to last forever. And let's be really strategic in how we use them and how do we build the right infrastructure, layer on the right you know, technology, pour more into our teachers, into professional development, into, you know, the more we pour into them, the more they'll pour into our students, which your podcast has covered beautifully with many of your guests. And how do we accelerate the rate of learning so that these students are better off than they would have been before the pandemic? But at the same time, it's kind of funny because you hear some of these leaders talking about this. And my question often to them is, why haven't we been talking about that before? Why did it take a pandemic to realize that our students are capable of a lot more than we're asking them to do? And you have kids, I have kids, you know, and a lot of your podcast guests have said, you know, if you give your kids the right amount of responsibility and expectations, they're able to achieve more oftentimes than we give them credit for. And so I think we really need to look system-wide at our K-12 system and what are those expectations, and not test expectations, but student growth expectations. How do we enable every student to reach their potential? And how do we inspire them to want to reach higher, right? To, you know, take a, you know, real ownership of their learning path, whatever that is, if that's higher ed, if that's career and technical, if that's, you know, going into the military, whatever it is, how do we get them to want to take those steps necessary to achieve, you know, their own personal goals and greatness? And so, again, I think that was a long-winded answer to your question, but as I end up talking with more and more people in the real world these days, I often get passionate and talk about education. And I try to give people hope that things are getting better. Things have been getting better for a while now. I know it's easy to focus on the learning loss and the negative, but things really are getting better. There's more promise and potential for our students and for the learning experiences that they're having now than there ever have been before. So hopefully everyone I talk to, I'm an evangelist for progress that we've already made and celebrating that, and also so much more potential that we have to move forward with right now, not next year or in 5 years, right now it's happening. And I always like to pause and thank the educators listening, the administrators listening. You've come through the hardest 18 plus months ever in history of education as well. So thank you for your service, and hopefully to you, you know, there's hope at the end of the tunnel. We're coming out of this thing and we're gonna come out of it better than we were before.
So two quick questions before we get to our final series of questions.
Sure.
One, when can folks, when and where can folks find your new podcast that's going to be launching?
Yeah. So season two of Voices of eLearning is going to be launching in January. You can find it on any where you listen to podcasts, also on marketscale.com, and then Accelerating K-12 Education. Same thing, will be available everywhere, and also on Summit K12 eLearning.com. And we're just couldn't be more excited for both of those shows to keep every week bringing more thought leaders to the table. And as you know, as a host, I learn more every time I do these and get more inspired than ever. I just listened to your recent episode about gratitude, and I'm like, oh man, I gotta like do some more gratitude every day and with my teams and, you know, with our schools. So we're excited to have these shows and to have such a great following that we've built over the last year or so, and would love for everyone to check them out.
Yeah, and the other question is, for people who don't know you, anybody who does know you knows that you're a very intentional person and you follow your heart well. And so you made a change recently to, I think, Summit K12. And I'm just curious what it was about that organization and what you're excited about, the vision of what you guys are trying to accomplish, why you're part of that leadership team now.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. And so Summit K12, I think what really drew me to them was their purpose and their mission. And so they play off of the mountain theme of, you know, reaching the summit of the mountain. And their tagline is enabling every student to reach their summit. So they're very big on differentiation, on equity, and not just equality, which I think another one of your shows has talked about. It's not enough just to give everyone a device, to give them an internet connection, but you really have to meet them with where they're at, with their content that speaks to them and their language and their interest and that type of thing. So they have a really big heart for equity for students. They work a lot in language development with ESL and emergent bilingual students, which is student population that needs more resources and more focus. And they also work a lot in science. And I've almost went into being a science major. I've had a heart for science. And it's interesting, you know, language development and science don't maybe make sense on the surface, but vocabulary for science is a second language. And if you're an ESL student, it's a third language. And so the logo for Summit is two mountaintops. One is the language summit that you're trying to reach with your students, that students are trying to reach, and the other is content. In this case, science, eventually we'll add math and social studies. And so you can't do one or the other. You can't just teach them fifth grade science if they're not reading at a fifth grade level. And you can't just work on language development for years and years before you start talking about content. You have to do them at the same time. And so many educators, especially at the lower levels, aren't necessarily experts in both. And so I really love that Summit is doing something different than anyone else and really building language and content cross-curricular just from the beginning foundationally, and then scaffolding to meet each student where they're at, language development and content development, so that you're not just dumbing down the content, you're strategically meeting the student where they're at and helping them build the content and build the language at the same time. We all know that if students can't read proficiently by certain levels, third grade, fifth grade, that they have a really tough time for the rest of their academic career and for their life. And full circle, if we're all going to be lifelong learners now, we can't give up on these students ever. We have to, you know, stay with it. Even if they're in high school and reading at a very low level, we can really reach those students and empower those teachers to use our programs and to inspire them at the same time to, hey, here's where you're at. You don't have to be here forever. You can move forward one step by one step. So that was the reason for the change here. It's fast growing company that is really puts the customer first and is really innovative and building into some of the artificial intelligence and things like that I talked about. So it was not something I was looking for. It was something that found me, as often happens in life and in your career. And I couldn't be more excited to be there and get to bring podcasting and things to, an EdTech company. There's not a lot out there that do it. I think Franklin Covey Education doing this show is just phenomenal. I am also a huge fan of the show. So if there's ever a quiz game show or something on all of your past guests and the content, I would love to be a participant in that, because I just couldn't. I tell everybody I know about this show. The highest compliment I think I can pay you is I don't even listen to my own shows, and I spot check other shows. This is the one show that I literally listen to every week, and time is so valuable for everyone. I love it, and I hope you keep going for many years.
Awesome, man. Well, I wouldn't be here without you. You know that. I know how much you love being at Market Scale and you love the folks there. And so for you to take this jump, I knew it was something that, you know, was you thought a lot about. And so I have no doubt about the integrity of the work that Summit K12 is doing and you're going to be a part of. So I'm just excited to see where that takes you. We've been closing out this season with three quick questions. And one of them, I started asking, you know, what do you read? You know, what are you reading on a regular basis, or what books really impact you? But really, in today's day and age, we consume information differently, right? There are podcasts we listen to, there are audiobooks we listen to, there are maybe news shows we watch, or YouTube. So my question for you is, what are you consuming? How do you consume your information, and what are you either reading or listening to on a regular basis that's helping you grow?
Yeah, and that's a really great question. And I'll be the first to admit, even if you knew me years ago, I'm not a huge reader, which I've always felt bad about. I feel like I'm in academics, I'm in education, I should be reading a book a week. It's just never been my core strength learning modality. But I am a huge fan of things like Masterclass. And just a shameless plug for Masterclass. They have some phenomenal content. Some of it is very entertainment focused. Pulled up my app here, Neil deGrasse Tyson, talking about the power of communication. Chris Voss talking about negotiation, Ron Finley about gardening. I would never read a book about gardening, but this guy, Ron Finley, he's called the Gangster Gardener. And I got a garden going with my kids now because I was inspired by it, because it's visual and it's easy to consume 10-minute, you know, kind of video modules. What else? Jeff Goodby and Rich Silverstein on marketing and storytelling. Matthew Walker talking about the science of sleep, which is amazing. Everyone should know that. How is that not taught in school? Dan Pink, who you've had on your show, talking about how everyone is a salesman to some degree, because you're selling your ideas, you're selling your children on why they should get in the car and go to school. What else? David Axelrod and Karl Rove talking about campaign strategies from both sides of the political aisle. Just super interesting. LinkedIn Learning also, I love consuming their short form, content. And I do Audible also. So I do read books audibly. A couple of books recently, The Power of Moments and Made to Stick, two books by Chip and Dan Heath, Oversubscribed by Daniel Priestley, talking about the value of scarcity. And then, of course, a classic, Carol Dweck's Mindset. I just read that again recently. So, I don't read a book a week. I would say I consume more than a book a week of content through other mediums. So I love that you asked that question in that way, because a lot of people, hopefully that gives someone else out there a little hope. If you're not a voracious reader, you can still better yourself every day, every week, and consume content in the way that, you know, if it's TikTok or YouTube, that's still, as long as you're intentional with it and you don't get off task, it's still a great way to always be learning.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, I had joined TikTok as like investigating how are all these mediums impacting learning. And then I found a few folks that put content out there, you know, whether it's a faith perspective, a learning perspective, a sports perspective, where I was actually watching the clips and learning and taking notes. So to your point, like, yeah, I mean, I think traditionally, you know, my wife is definitely a reader. I'm just a little bit behind her on the reading scale, but I'm always consuming information. And I believe every great leader is someone who is constantly trying to grow themselves and learn. And I know that about you, the reading part, as well as the constant, you know, collecting information. And so I was just curious for you to answer that for folks of how do you get information? Because I know that you're always in learning mode.
Absolutely. And the one thing I would say is be intentional and write it down. Just consuming, it could kind of go in one ear and out the other. But really taking notes and writing it down, setting reminders for yourself to put things into practice, like gratitude. I got a reminder every day at 4:45 to spend 15 minutes. Otherwise, I'll be like, oh, that's a great idea. And then a week later, I've got another great idea. So really be intentional and write it down and commit to, you know, one thing, each week or each day that you want to stick with. And if it works, keep doing it. And if it doesn't, you'll find the next thing. But for a while there, I was kind of information overload, because you can, you know, really sink your teeth into all this info. But if it doesn't stick, then it's not really making an impact on your life. And I know that's what your Change Starts Here podcast is all about, is not just consuming information once a week, but really taking those nuggets away that are going to make an impact on your life and the lives of the people around you. So be intentional for sure.
Yep. So I'm excited about this question, given I know your history being in music and being a musician yourself. What are you listening to? And this is when your kids are not in the car, because there may be a different answer. But what are you listening to? Not that you listen to bad music. It just, you may want to put on like Cocomelon like songs when your kids are in the car. What are you listening to when you're driving around Dallas?
Yeah. And I didn't know if you were going to ask me this one or not, because we could spend about another hour just talking music. I grew up in a musical family. My dad was a drummer in the 60s and 70s. My mom was not only a teacher, but also a band teacher and a orchestra conductor, and taught private lessons at home from 5 to 9 every night, voice lessons, every instrument you can imagine. So I grew up with music and played in the band for a number of years. So music is a huge part of my life. For me right now, I know it's obligatory to say the Beatles, but there have been so many great documentaries about them recently on different platforms. I've really dove back into them and kind of the behind the scenes, behind the story, that these are just four regular guys. They aren't kind of these like stratospheric, superstars that we, have always thought of them as. So I thought that was cool. So I love the old school, 60s and 70s rock stuff. And then I'm a kid of the 90s. So I love bands like the Avett Brothers and Guster and Guilty Pleasure for John Mayer, even though I don't really like the guy. Some of his music is just so good. When I need to get some work done or work out, there's a band called Cake that is kind of obscure, that I love to listen to. So, and then Dave Matthews is kind of the other obligatory 90s guy, jam band musician, I have the Sirius XM channel, and you get to hear all of his live concerts through the decades. And you always just hear something different, something new. So music is a huge part of my life. I start the day with it. I try to incorporate it throughout the day, and then try to impart it into my kids as well. So there's a song by the Rolling Stones called "You Can't Get What You Can't Always Get What You Want." And I think that's just a good message for them to learn at a young age. So we'll play that in the car, and they sing so loud. I don't know if they fully get it yet, because they're 4 and 2, but they just love to sing. And so if I can impart that into the kids with a little bit of contemporary, or to me, contemporary music, old music, besides the Disney music and all that fun stuff, then I feel like I get some dad points for getting some of that into my kids' ears at a young age.
I'm curious to see how that goes after Christmas. It seems like you're getting them started with "Can't Always Get What You Want." I'm going to see how that goes. You can tell me what we learned.
I'll let you know if it backfires.
All right. Well, dude, last question. All the great guests that we have on here are constantly, again, they're all learners, but they're always surrounded by really talented people as well. What's the best piece of either leadership advice or, personal growth change advice you've received recently that you just can't get out of your mind that you want others to know about?
Yeah. So for me, this question is deeply personal. And I don't know if I've talked to you in the last couple of months, but my father unexpectedly passed away Labor Day, and had a heart attack. He was only 73 and was obviously a big inspiration in my life. He in 73 years probably lived more life than people live in 100. And it kind of ties back to Dan Pink's episode with you as well about regret. And I would say my dad did not live a life of regret. He may regret a few of the things he did in his life, but I don't think he had any regrets of not taking an opportunity and not doing something. That he was always creating a new sports team for us as his kids. He was always just thinking big and acting big, and just had a heart for other people. He just could talk to the store clerk for an hour and make them feel like they have been best friends their whole lives. People just on Facebook came out of the woodworks from high school, people he impacted. And so for me, I think it's just living that life of taking chances, taking a new opportunity when it comes along, starting a podcast. I never thought I'd start a podcast, and just not having any regrets of things that you didn't do is really something that's been on my heart for the last couple of months. And something that I wanted to share with the audience, that if you want to leave a mark on the world, on your family, have a life of impact, to just do it. Don't overthink it. Do some preparation and don't be reckless, but if you got a passion, follow it and really be aware of the impact that it can have, not just on yourself, but on others around you and on the world.
Well, JW, as I say, cornily, I don't know if it's in word, I'm a little cheesy when it comes to like my appreciation for you, because obviously we're good friends, but every time I'm around you, I always just want to make sure you know what kind of impact you had on my life at a very formative age, around 18, 19, that set me on a really cool trajectory with my life. And it's funny to say that around the time when we reconnected after a number of years, you set me back on this podcasting life. And so it's just crazy. It's cool to see how you're being used to impact so many others. And I just feel blessed to be a part of it. So thank you for being on here today. I know we joked about thinking about JW Marshall's name next to the Dan Pinks of the world, but in terms of how you impact people around you, how you impact organizations you work with, and how you help, you know, everything get better and improve things, you belong right there with every guest that we have. And I just appreciate you making time to be here with us.
Hey, and I appreciate you, and for everyone out there that helps others. You know this too. You've had an impact on me just as much, if not more. So you always get more when you give more. So hopefully that'll be another word of inspiration for everybody to just go out there and do kind things for other people, and it'll come back to you more, even more so than the time you're putting in to help others.
So true. All right. Well, Dubs, or JW, sorry. No, I only refer to him as Dubs. So Dubs, it's been awesome. Thanks for making time. We'll talk later, man.
All right. Thanks. Have a good one.
All right. See ya.
Please support us by subscribing to our YouTube channel, podcast on Apple or Spotify, and help us celebrate the beautiful, messy work of shaping human potential.